No coffee in 45 minutes. That'd be great. Only first coffee. No. All right, go ahead. Yeah, the only thing about Fan Day that I'm upset about is that they have to do a lottery for the kids to, for me to sign. I'd love to be able to do it for everybody. So what I'm excited is a chance for our players to interact with the fans, to recognize that, you know, everyone talks about what's your why. You know, everyone has their own personal ones. We want to have a team win, but we want to have a great experience for the fans. So excited to get it done. Yeah, you know, Jeff has a quiet way about him that I like. I think one of the things I've learned is let people be themselves and just try to make them help them be the best version of themselves. So I want him to lead in a way that he feels comfortable with. And I see him exerting his presence in, you know, more and more often. I think Jeff's a triple threat. You know, he can run it, he can throw it, and he can beat you with his brain. He's smart. So he's not super talked about outside of Nebraska circles. I think he's going to play really well. The last thing I'll say is I think everyone plays for him. The guys play for him. Like they want to see him be successful. He cares about all the guys on the team and spends a lot of time with all the guys on the team. Yeah, I think it's about getting in the right play when there's a check. It's about audibling to a man beater when you got man coverage. It's about sliding the protections. It's about knowing where to go versus different coverages. It's getting the ball to the right guy. Like, you know, there's this documentary on Netflix right now called Quarterback, right? And I think what everyone's probably seeing is it's not really like, you know, it's not really about who has the best arms. It's about who has the best brain, the best mindset, the best feel for the game, who has the mental strength to overcome the physical beating that you take. So I think Jeff has all those things. I think Jeff's an NFL player if he will just continue to develop. Yeah, you know, Xavier had to come back. He had to pass 18 credits to be eligible just because of the time away. He had missed credits, so he had to, you know, get his degree percentage. At the same time, you know, he had to do all, you know, he was going to do football too. So really pleased with him. He's a really, really smart young man, highly intelligent, and he cares about people. So I think Xavier's special in that regard. Not only did he pass 18, he passed 21 credits, which is, you know, that's hard to do. And hopefully Xavier sees, you know, what he's capable of. He's certainly capable of a lot football-wise. My job is to have people understand that success isn't talent. Success is achievement. Just because you're talented doesn't mean you're successful. Yeah, you take that talent and you achieve something, it means you're successful. And I'm really proud of what Xavier achieved this spring and this summer as well, on and off the field.
Matt, you're asked about what?
Yeah, you know, we had a speaker come in a couple last year, and Kevin Eastman. Kevin worked with the Celtics, and we started talking about their team goals. The first year that they brought, you know, the big three, Kevin Garnett. I'm not a basketball fan, so I'll probably say, I don't want to make anyone mad and say the wrong names, but Kevin Garnett, you know, came in and said, like, hey, my goal for this year is to make everyone, you know, appreciate and respect what the Celtic jersey means again. And so, like, for me, when I think about Nebraska, I just think about that helmet. You know, it's just like, it's iconic to me. It's all across college football what that means. And, you know, are we being talked about right now? I mean, you know, are people talking about, wow, it's, you know, I'm not talking about within Nebraska, I'm talking about nationally. And so for me, this is about us as a program, from the way we practice to the way we travel to the way we carry ourselves. Like, I told Keith Bannon this morning, I wanted to be the first guy here this morning. Like, I just want us to do everything better than everyone else. And that pride, that respect that we have for each other and the way that we do things, you've heard me say many times, like, I don't want our fans coming to the games just because they love Nebraska. I want them coming because they love Nebraska and they know they're going to see a good football team. And so there's a lot on us that we have to do. And so if we're making progress towards that, then people will respect who we are, our players will respect who we are, our opponents will respect who we are, and that's the first step towards championship mindset.
There's a sense of, like, wanting to be as good as possible, as soon as possible. But you also talk about being patient, not getting ahead of yourself. What are the things in the first year that you want to be urgent about, the things that you don't want to compromise on at all? What are the things that you know you might
Yeah, so when I say patience, I don't mean patient in terms of like the results at all. Like my like we are it's fourth and goal every single day in our building. That's the mindset. It's fourth and goal every day. Like, you know, I go away to see my family at the beach, and everyone's like, "I know you're on vacation." I'm not on vacation. I'm working from the beach. Like, this is 24/7, 365. Like we're chasing greatness. I mean, everyone here is sprinting to stay ahead of us. We got to catch them and then get whatever we want to be. So the urgency is elite. It's just I don't want to skip steps along the way. Does that make sense? I don't want to take shortcuts. I don't want to build something that, like, hey, we show everybody a little bit of hope this year, but then the next year we take a step back. So I never want year two to be year one, if that makes sense. So this is year one. You know, I want us to win every game. I want us to, but like I'm not right now. I can't think about the games. I expect us to do everything right. I expect that, you know, guys to show up on Sunday and be on time. And so it's just this mindset of everything matters, everything counts. That's all I mean. So I don't want anyone to take, like, hey, Coach Wilson, hey, calm down, don't get excited. No, there's no one that's more anxious for this than me. It's just that I know the only way we can win the game is if we're awesome all camp. So that's the mindset, you know. And I want our guys to just have this stable, steady every single day. Because, like, all right, we play Minnesota game one. What if we win? What if we lose? Like, we still play the next week, don't we? Like, so, like, you know, our guys learned the hard way last year. When you start being like, this is an important game and this isn't, well, Georgia Southern happens. So I don't want us thinking that way. Every single game is an important game. And as I say that, the former players, they kind of laugh. They'll be like, oh, Coach Osborne used to say that all the time. We'd roll our eyes. I'm like, yeah, but that Coach Osborne figured it out before I did. And so I'm just doing the same thing that the people who won in Nebraska did.
When did punctuality become a rattler? Because it seems like being on time is hard now.
Yeah, because I think everyone's kind of like on time-ish, you know? Like, you know, you show up at 8:04. It's like, well, I'm here. Like, no, if you have a meeting with me, be here at 8. Like, actually be early, you know? So it's just because I'm willing to act on it, it seems like a bigger deal. I can promise you our players are way more disciplined than most programs. I can promise you that. It's just if you're going to be late to breakfast 3 or 4 times, or you're going to miss breakfast or something, I'm going to take actions. Not because I don't love you, but in fact because I do care greatly about what I can't have guys leaving our program and going out in the real world and not functioning. I'll feel like a failure. And so we're gonna treat our building like it's the real world. Like, guys would walk into when I was at the Giants, guys would walk into a meeting early, and Coach Coughlin, he wouldn't say a word to me. Just the fine, right? And I say, you know, they have a $2,000 fine, or they miss something, they have a $14,000 fine. I don't want players from Nebraska playing in the NFL and getting fined. I want them knowing to be 5 minutes early. You know, actually get there 10 minutes early, put your phone down and talk to people, and watch how the world opens up for you. Well, obviously, I think the NFL. Well, I think just being around the football and the players, I learned a lot. You know, you know, we're talking about recovery. When you're coaching someone like Christian McCaffrey, like, you learn everything that there is out there. Like, hey, coach, there's this thing here, this thing there. So, you know, we're building a lot of things in our building. I think for me, on a personal note, like, every job I had taken before that had a happy ending. So, you know, you kind of always assume it's going to work out. And for me, you know, I'm probably a lot better now because I'm coming off of some adversity. And then see, like, I learned a lot about, you know, leadership by leading in tough times. It's easy to lead when things are going well. It's easy to lead when you're winning every game. You know, when you're about to get fired and everyone's calling, you know, this whole stadium's booing for you to get fired. Like, look around here, guys. Think about if they were going, like, fire Sipple, fire here, how that would feel. And your kids are in the stands. Like, but I did that. And you know what I learned? I'm tough. And my family's tough. And you know what? After that happened, I went home and saw my daughters. I played with them. I hung out. I didn't take it home. And I learned a lot about, hey, sometimes as a leader, you have to be the one out front taking the bullets so that people behind you can move forward. So keeping that team together through that adversity was something that I'm not proud of. And so as I come to Nebraska now, like, I know if I do something, there's going to be a lot of different opinions about it. And you know what? I respect everyone, but I'm going to do what I think is right, because I've seen what happens when everyone has an opinion. I've got to do what I think is right and be tough enough to just stand with it. Like, if I think, you know what, guys, we're going to wear this color cleats, we're going to wear this color cleats. Hey, guys, we're going to do that. Like, someone's going to be upset maybe, but I owe it to the University of Nebraska to go all in. I can't go half in and gauge the temperature of everyone. I got to go all in. And so I maybe wouldn't have been able to do that if I had not gone through what I just went through.
So you've already been in two programs where nobody in the room when you arrived, you had a win at Temple and at Baylor. Now you're in the same situation. How do you take a group of players that aren't used to winning and get that turned around?
Yeah, you know, and to me it's unique in Nebraska because there, you know, there's been all these games that are so close, like literally, you know how ESPN has like that predictor, like you're 90. I bet you most games in the fourth quarter, Nebraska wasn't favored to win. And so, to me, it's all these things. Like, I talk a lot about being on time. I talk a lot about, well, you know what? Like, if I can't count on you to show up to things in the summer, I don't know that I can count on you to be inside leverage when you're supposed to be inside leverage. Like, because it's these little things that cause winning and losing. So, it's the strength program. It's the nutrition program. It's our guys getting bigger and stronger because, you know what? The stronger, more physical team usually wins in the fourth quarter. They wear the other team out instead of getting worn out. So it's our approach to the offseason. It's our approach to discipline, which to me is just doing what you say you're going to do. And it's also confidence. Like, I want our guys to be confident that we're going to win, even when it looks like maybe like the odds are against us. And so putting them in those situations in practice, inoculating them against that stress, because we have a bunch of good players. They'll play great at practice. My job is to get them to play great in the games the way they do at practice. And a lot of that is just helping them overcome stress, overcoming the fear of failure. So we'll do everything from we'll read a book during preseason camp that talks about it, to guys do mindfulness, guys do yoga, we yell and scream at practice so they learn to just tune things out. There's a reason for everything that we do, and hopefully it ends up working sooner than rather than later.
Promised all easy questions for you. You were walk-on in college.
Sir.
What does that say, obviously, tradition in college football? It's not all the stars come in, but how does that help you evaluate talent, knowing that you were walk-on one time, to evaluate these kids to make them better?
Yeah, I think when you're a walk-on, you're I always kind of laugh, like, you know, you show up at 5:30 in the morning to get yelled at by someone like me at practice and do hard things, and you're paying to do it. It's beautiful. And so you know that those guys love the game. The ones that we have, they love Nebraska. I loved Penn State. And they want to be there for all the right reasons. So as much as we talk about all the things that are wrong in college football, I can point out a lot of things that are right. And so I think that's really important. And at the same time, you know, I look at, you know, one of the best players in football today is Hassan Reddick. He was a walk-on for me at Temple. I learned pretty early on, like, who they are at 18 is not necessarily who they are at 22 or who they are at 27. So we try to give everyone a chance. And by a chance, I mean reps and opportunities and chances to show what they can do. So, and I think for me, like, I love the game because I love the game. And I probably always have a little bit of chip on my shoulder because I knew at Penn State I was going to get a chance. I just knew I wasn't going to get as many chances as everybody else. So I didn't have an opportunity to, like, let things slide. I had to be grateful for my chances and make the most of them. And that's kind of how I feel now coming to Nebraska. Like, I'm getting a chance to do this. I got to make the most of it.
Thanks, coach. Going back to your NFL experience, did anything draw you back to college, specifically Nebraska, or did it just kind of happen?
Yeah, I think that I was, you know, we're all meant to do something. We all have a purpose through our lives. I was meant to work with this age group. You know, when I did get fired, it was almost like I was getting eulogized the next day. Like, all my former players were texting me and reaching out to me. And, hey, coach, you know, you meant this to me. Hey, coach, you helped me do this. And for me and my purpose, you know, working with young people, I just enjoy the college game. I enjoy recruiting. I enjoy getting to know the parents. I enjoy watching guys graduate. I enjoy watching guys get jobs, have kids. I'm now starting to get to the point where guys I coach, their kids are starting to come up. Scary but true. And so my wife and kids, like, they missed college. Like, in college, they knew everyone. Like, they knew the families. They, on the away games, they sit in the stands, like, you know, with the, you know, and all of a sudden now they're in the NFL and they don't know any of the players. They certainly don't know their families. So, and part of my NFL experience was also COVID, so that was kind of off too. But I just like being around young people in these formative years and watch them become things that maybe they didn't know they were going to be. Yeah, I like recruiting. I like route. Well, first of all, if you like to compete, don't you like, you know, I like to compete in recruiting, you know? So to me, like, when you recruit, you have a chance to compete at everything you do. And I like to recruit. I really like to evaluate first. Let me say that. Sometimes people will tell me that there's a lot of talk about, oh, they took this guy who's unrecruited, that guy who's unrecruited. Why should what someone else is doing, their opinion of a player, affect my opinion? That means I'm weak. So, like, I like to evaluate. We had 3,000 kids, I think, come through our camps. You know, I took 1,000 pictures with youth campers 2 days in a row. Like, I like people, first of all. But I like evaluating. I like watching people. I like, say, looking at a kid at 15, 16, 17 and being like, that kid's going to be this when he's 22. So, you're not always right. But I like the projection. I like all that. I like watching tape. But then I also like relationships and families. I like having people come in. And I just have learned, like, oh, bro. Let's not say anything. No one tweet it. I don't need anyone coming to me with, why'd you get coffee? But also, like, you know, what I've learned is I'm really not recruiting anyone to come to Nebraska. I'm telling each person who we are, what we do, why we do it. And then for each guy, I'm saying, here's our vision for you, and here's our plan to get you there. And if it works for them, great. And if it doesn't, we wish them the best. And, like, I'm not a slick talker. I'm not going to sit there and be like, you need to come here because of this. You need to come here because of that. Like, I put that, like, New York City side of me to the side, and I have an 18-year-old son. All I pray for is that my son ends up in the right place with the right people. If he ends up in the wrong place, I don't know. So I don't want kids coming to Nebraska that it's the wrong place. I want them coming for the right reasons. So I love recruiting, and I think we're doing a pretty good job. I'm not the rankings and the numbers and all that. Like, we had kids come to our camp that ran 4.38, 4.42, broad jump 10.5, and had pro agilities. I don't care who else offered them. Like, if I can't coach a guy that runs that fast and jumps that high, then I can't coach. So that's kind of the fun part to me also, is finding the guys that are out there. And I'm really happy with our camps, having that many guys. At first, the first camp was only like 150, 160, and then it just kind of slowly grew. And I think I'm hoping we can get to 4,000 or 5,000 kids next year, because I want people all across the state of Nebraska and near anywhere to come knowing they're going to have a great experience. Yeah, June was hard, first of all. I thought I was going to have a couple people quit on the staff. There was one Friday we had an official visit, a morning practice, an afternoon practice. And I think most schools around the country, what they're doing is they're letting the GAs coach the camp, and they're doing the official visit. I'm not doing that. Like, we coached the camp, did the official visit. It was really hard. But on that weekend, on Sunday, it was so good for me and the staff to be like, did it work? Like, just did it work? Well, we offered a bunch of kids that came to the camp that we didn't really know a ton about, or that we liked, but we weren't sure. And then we had a bunch of guys commit. And so a lot of parents, and I think a lot of kids nowadays, they're recognizing, like, if these coaches work this hard at camp or this hard at official visit, how are they going to work on my academics, my health, my mental health? Like, they're probably going to be pretty intentional about that. So I think June was a big success, not just for this year, but for the future. Now, you know, recruiting, like, everyone's going to, they're committed. People are going to come after them. They're going to want them to come. But you know what? We're going to go after guys too. So, I mean, there's still a lot of recruiting left to be done.
Matt, you said you're going to read a book during camp. You're an avid reader. You got specific books you like. There's something specific that you want to
see? Yeah. And I won't say the book just because it'll get out in 1 minute. But well, I'll tell the book. So Donnie Rayola is going to do he'll do a team wide book. He did it last year with the O-line, but he'll do a team wide. Like a book club, like we'll do it, like let's say 15 minutes a day, 3 days a week for 2 weeks. The book's called Twin Thieves. It's a great book. Donnie gave it to me early on. It's kind of like what they call an allegory, like, you know, it's kind of like about, I don't know if allegory is the right term. If it is, forgive me. But it's basically about a coach working with a fictional team and helping the guys learn how to overcome doubt, fear of failure. So Donnie and I read all the same books. Like, people always ask, why did you hire him? When I walked in his office and I saw the books he had, I was like, man, me and this guy are definitely alike, because I only read a certain type of book for the most part, and we had all the same base one. So, and it's cool for me. Like, he's going to do that part of it. You know, Dr. Haskell's going to do all the mindfulness and meditation. It's not just me in front of the team. It's Garrett and Terrence are going to do, you know, the quarterback show. They're going to pull out clips and show guys. So all of our coaches have a chance now to get in front of the team at some point.
Is that recruiting?
No. No, if you know him, he's a psychopath in terms of that. So he reads the same things.
With recruiting, how do you think the TV deals being on NBC, CBS, Fox will impact Nebraska's recruiting?
It's phenomenal. To think that we'll be on Fox national TV the first two games of the year. You know, when you're, I was in New Jersey the last couple of weeks, right? Like, people see me, they'll say, Coach, Nebraska, day after Thanksgiving. Oh, yeah, these iconic TV memories for people all across the country. To think that now that people are going to turn on NBC, they're going to turn on CBS, they're going to turn on Fox and see us playing on national TV, they're going to see the environment that's at. And I think another thing is the presentation, the game presentation is going to be elite. Like, you watch a game on NBC, like, they're going to show Nebraska. One of the biggest things for us is, when you go outside the state, people don't really know what's in Lincoln. They don't know what's in Nebraska. They don't know what's at Memorial. I didn't know. I had to come out and see it. And so I know the teams that are at NBC, CBS, and Fox, they're going to present that in a way that helps us in recruiting at a high level.
Coach, you mentioned on the stage just now about those iconic Colorado and Nebraska names growing up and just how much of a, you know, must-see for those. Just curious, you know, I mean, now in this role, are you appreciating that rivalry even more? And also, are you, from afar, are you taking a look at kind of what Coach Sanders has going on and, you know, just any interactions with him over the time?
Yeah, you know, I've never met Coach Sanders. I recruited a young man from Trinity Catholic, Quaylen Jones, to Baylor. That was his high school. But on the day that I went in, Coach wasn't in. So I dealt with his assistant head coach and just, you know, thanked them for letting us recruit him. Yeah, I think Nebraska-Colorado is good for football. You know, I think you know, as many of the old Big Eight games as we could play, the better. You know, I mean, I think it's great when everyone could drive to all the games and see the games. What I don't want is, I don't want just football like in this part of the country, in this part of the country. I want it. East to west, north to south, because I think it's good for the game in the long run. So, in terms of what Colorado's doing, man, I'm so busy with myself. I don't know. My son's on social media, so he'll show me something every now and then. But, you know, I think it's awesome. Coach Sanders is making Colorado highly, highly relevant, and we're trying to do the same thing.
Iowa-Nebraska rivalry. I'm sure you're familiar. They don't like each other very much. How, you know, what do you think about that? Just, you know, being preserved, and you guys are going to play each other once a year for a long time.
Yeah, it's unique for me because when I was in the Big Ten at Penn State, no, Nebraska wasn't. And so, you know, we played Iowa. We had a chance. I thought we were going to go to the national championship in, I think it was 95 into 96 or 96. I can't remember the year. And Tim Dwight took a punt and returned back for a touchdown against us, and it kind of ruined the year for us. We ruined going to the national championship. We still went like 10-2, I think, but going to the national championship game. So the Iowa-Nebraska rivalry is kind of new to me, right? Like in terms of seeing it, obviously that game this year was huge. But I think having a regional rival, I think having a game that everyone can drive to, I think it's good. I think it's really good. A lot of respect for Coach Ferentz. You know, he's done it his way, the right way, for a really long time. It's awesome. So, yeah, I'm excited about the schedule moving forward. You know, I really don't care who we play in terms of in conference. You know, out of conference, I got a lot of opinions on things like that. But in conference, like, we got to play them all, you know. So I do know this. You know, our players didn't come here to play bad teams. They came to Nebraska to play against the best. So, you know, I was a great team, and it would be an honor to play them.
So what are the opinions of
guys? Sorry?
So what is the opinion?
Oh, no, that's my late-night text messages to Trev. I'll keep those ones quiet.
Matt, what has your communication been with Trev about just the moving to the new facility? Just, you know, you're starting practice this weekend. How will that go? How will that process happen as far as when you guys will make that move?
Yeah, we have a weekly, Susan and I have a weekly Zoom call with the people over there. And as much as I want to get in, I also want it to be done right. You know, I don't want to get in and then have, you know, things around us. So, you know, Trev, I mean, as you guys know, Trev's visionary. He's awesome. He handles all the details of those things, but they keep us abreast. I think at some point in training camp, we'll probably move the players in. We were hoping before, but, you know, I walk out in the field the other day, and I see two beautiful grass fields and new turf fields being laid, and I'm like, you know what? Sometimes you have to just be a little bit patient to wait for things to be done and done right. You know, the coaches, I think we'll probably stay over in our offices in meeting rooms for right now, and maybe sometime, you know, in this training camp or fall, we'll move in. But the biggest thing to me is I want the players to be able to move into the locker room, training room, recovery area, because the recovery area is going to be phenomenal as soon as possible, so probably at some point during camp.
Do you have a vision for how you want to run the ball without ever having to use that? Obviously, you want to use it, and run it. How do you want to run the ball just with the running back? Do you have a number that you want to get to, or kind of
yeah.
How it's supposed to work?
Yeah, well, I'll say this. I think that when you look at how you run the ball, take the quarterback out of it, to your point. I have a couple core philosophies. Like, A, always look at what your O-line does well, right? Now, we're gonna play some 3-4 fronts. We're going to run different things against the 3-4 fronts than we will against the 4-down fronts. I always believe that, you know, a yard outside the tackles and outside play is equal to 2 yards inside. Like, inside the tackles, it's kind of like a body blow. It's just, you know, it's right up the middle. So we'll be stubborn to a fault, but I also know that we're going to have to be able to throw it. We're going to have to be able to be explosive. We're going to have to run the quarterback. So, you know, I want to be diverse in what we do. You know, we're going to run inside zone, outside zone, power, counter. We're not going to just live off of one thing. But I just want to make sure that we have an interior run game as well, right? So if 1 week I have to spread you out to be able to run the ball inside, I will. If we have to get in tight to condense you, then we will. But I just want people to, when they play us, to line up and have several different things. You know, so there's two different philosophies. Like, we'll play some teams, and they'll say, we run these two runs all the time. We're methodical with them. we're going to try to be a little more diverse. We're going to run a bunch of plays. You know, the quarterback run game to me doesn't really count as rushing yardage. It's an outlier. It's an explosive, potentially explosive play. I don't want to run the quarterbacks to get 3 or 4 yards. I want to run the quarterbacks in a couple different ways. I want to run them. I want to run them when we're in the red zone. I want to run them on third down. So when the result is either continuing a drive or scoring, I want to run the quarterback when he's part of a zone read type play where we're hoping to give it, but if he pulls it, it's a big play. And then I think a lot of that what Jeff will do is he's going to drop back to throw it, and then he's going to put the ball down and run. And so those count as free yardage as well. So we don't want to just go out there and just be running quarterback power and getting 4 yards. But if you know if that happens, it happens. We want to be thoughtful with the ways that we use him.
What stubbornness going to get you by the fourth quarter?
Yeah, like you know, we're never going to say, like, hey, start fast, guys. Let's get off to a big lead. That's not us. Like, we hope we do. Like, we're just going to go out there and play, and then try to wear teams out in the fourth quarter. So, again, that doesn't mean there might be games where we come out and we throw out the first 10 plays of the game because that's what we think we need to do that game to loosen something. I mean, every game's a little bit different, but the core philosophy is we've got to stop the run and run the ball. We've got to protect our quarterback and attack their quarterback up front. So, the stubbornness just means at the end of the day, there's going to be some games, Sam, where you go out there to run the ball, and it's getting 3 yards, 4 yards. And I've been on those staffs where the coordinator's like, man, we can't run it today. And the O-line coach wants to fight. And, wow, we can run it. Like, we're going to keep running it. You know what I mean? Like, it doesn't mean we're not going to throw it. We're going to take 70% layup throws. We're going to push the ball down the field. But we're going to run the football and believe that the cumulative effect affects us. The last thing I'll say is there's times at Temple, but we're playing Penn State, Notre Dame. I'm like, bro, we can't run ISO against Notre Dame. Like, we tried it. We popped one for about 30 yards. They got so mad, that, you know. So then we had to spread them out. We run zone read. That wasn't really who we were, but we're going to find a way to run the ball, you know, somehow.
What is the most?
You know, my philosophy, I think the guys will tell you, like, I let everyone on our team speak. I'm not one of those guys who's like, hey, these four guys. Every player that plays for me has to learn how to talk to the media. I just thought these three guys, but Jeff's the quarterback, right? So, after every game, media's probably going to talk to me. They're probably going to talk to Jeff. So to not bring him here would be disingenuous. You know, and then I thought, like, Ethan Piper to me, like, he's truly our brand. Like, he's a Nebraska Cornhusker through and through. And then Luke, he's just prolific. He's been a great player. And he's a local guy. It's like a great story. So, but I could have brought any other guy. I could have brought Ty Robinson. I could have brought so many other guys. But I just thought these three guys were really good. And I think Jeff, he's new. He's never once said, well, this is how I did it before. Like, he's just embraced our culture and our way of doing things, and that's the hardest part in year one, is that all the guys, everything's new to them. The only person who knows what I'm going to do is Fleeks, because he played for me at Baylor. The rest of them are all kind of like, what's next? And Jeff's embraced it all as he's gone.
Coach Reimer could end up number two all time in Nebraska on contact.
Oh, you know why I know that? Because last night I said, you could end up number three, and he goes, no, number two. I was like, stop me.
What did it look like when you first saw
him? Did him play?
Yeah.
You know, I think, so I like to do two things. I like to watch both the All-22 videotape. I also like to watch a lot of TV copies to feel the game. Like, and he's made a lot of big plays and a lot of big moments, right? You can tell the defense was one that, like, if the offense lined up like this, it was shift, and he was so great at getting guys lined up. A lot of detail, a lot of really good football, and so. But I think the biggest thing for me is, as you see him on tape, he can go sideline to sideline, he can get off blocks, he can tackle, he's competitive, but he also has a penchant for making a big play, you know, a key interception, a key takeaway at the right time.
What is the most important thing? I know there's a lot of moving pieces and a lot of things are important to you. What is the most important thing for y'all to accomplish between now and Minnesota?
Well, my goal is that the guys that I say, hey, we're playing with these guys against Minnesota, I hope that I'm playing with the same guys 3 or 4 weeks later. You know, sometimes, you know, when you're a new coach, you go into the season like, hey, this is going to be the guys, and after 3 or 4 games, you're like, oh, I better change, and you go with these guys. I'm hoping we do a really good job of evaluating. And so part of that is giving guys a lot of opportunities. Like, you know, we'll have 2, 3, 4 drills going at all times. We'll scrimmage, we'll play, we'll see. You know, they've cut the rules back way back to, you can only be in 8 pads before the first game now in college football. Like, that's like, I read that, I thought it was a typo. I couldn't believe it. Like, 8 times, like, to get ready for a game, but the rules are the rules. I'm going to live with them. So, but I have to find ways to just constantly see, like, who can I count on, who's competitive, because I think finding the right guys in the right roles, a lot of guys can be really successful that are just in the right roles. So getting them in the right roles is hard. You know, you don't want to do it too soon because you jump the gun, and you don't want to do it too late because, you know, you play a game and you have the wrong guys playing.
When you talk about Nebraska being feared, I mean, how do you convey that message to 18 to 22-year-olds that simply aren't old enough to remember those names from 95, 97 games? Or is it
Well, yeah, there's a lot of guys from Nebraska. There's a lot of guys that have heard a lot about that over the last couple of years. I think for me, it's this teaching concept of like, listen, you're the 2023 Nebraska Cornhusker football team. And there's this continuum, you know. And there's a lot of people who came before you, and you have to learn from their lessons. You have to learn from everything that they've done. And they've allowed you to be here in this moment. And you have this beautiful moment to have your time to then affect all the people that are going to come after you. So we talk a lot about those who came before us. We also have to talk about those who come after us and what our legacy is going to be. And so understanding that continuum, I think, is really important. You know, do you want future teams to be feared? And so they can know what the 90s were. They can know what the early 2000s were. They can know about all those years. But really the focus, they didn't know that, but also then they have to go focus on right now. And so if we focus on right now and we're patient with it, hopefully we can be feared again someday.
You mentioned Frank, so I know you talk a lot about Coach Osborne, but is there anything from his career that you've taken out from Nebraska and then what he did after?
Then selfishly, I went to Ohio. Yeah. You know, it's funny. I talked to Coach Solich this spring. One of the things I talked about was how much respect I had for, like, you're talking about a guy that all the success he had as both a position player, position coach, and coordinator and then head coach running one offense, right? And then if you remember, he was at Ohio. He ran that same offense, and then he morphed. In 2005, maybe, and then no, I'm sorry, 2005 into 2006, and all of a sudden now they were spread type concepts, and there was no more fullback, and they were in 11 and 12 personnel. So he changed, and he had the same success. And I talked to Coach. He said, you know, we changed the personnel, but we kept the same core concepts and the same core game plan. So I think when you see coaches that can adjust over time, that's the mark of a true coach. Like, anybody can say, this is my system, find me the players to do it. My job and our job is to say, here's the players we have, what's the best system for them? As you recruit, you're recruiting to a system, but we have to be flexible. So, I mean, I was at Temple, we were four down. I was at Baylor, we were four down for a couple years, then we went to three down, and we won the league. Then I went to Carolina, the first year we were terrible on defense, we were like a 4-3. Then we went to like a 5-1 hybrid, and we were number two in defense. So, it's not about, well, I like to do this. It's about coming to Nebraska. What will win in Nebraska? What will win in the elements in Nebraska? And then always evolving to take advantage of the players that I have.
A couple months ago, they wanted to kind of build the offensive line back up, and they took some heat last year. Just wondering, where do you see them mentally approaching this season?
I think they're confident and ready to go, you know. And again, you know, my message to them is like if you spend all your time trying to prove other people wrong, you're gonna be miserable. Like, just prove yourself right. If you think you're a good player, go play like a good player, man. And we made some real strides in the weight room with those guys. I see them bending at a high level, taking care of. Donnie does a great job with the mentality. I mean, I was over there earlier with Piper. I said, okay, you're holding me in one hand and Donnie in the other hand. You have to let go of one of us to peril. He's like, Coach, I'm sorry. He's letting go of me. So, like, that's the unity they built over there. So, you know, it's going to be a work in progress. We have to do a good job as coaches, though, of calling plays and doing things that they do well, right? Like, I worked for Kevin Gilbride at the Giants. I was assistant O-line coach. And, like, he was going to protect the O-line. He knew that Eli couldn't play well if the O-line didn't play well. And how do I help the O-line play well? I'm going to protect him. I'm going to chip this guy. I'm going to run this play that we run well. So my job is to help our coaches figure out what we do well and then go do those things and let our guys play. You know, I've done it a couple times. You know, I went back as an assistant coach. I went back as the head coach at Temple twice. Lost the last game. We got a terrible call, lost the game. But I can't get fined for that, right? Because that was American, right? So, you know, played them at home, beat them at home for the first time in 70. You know, beat them for the first time in 74 years, which was a big moment for Temple University. So, you know, I love James Franklin. Grateful for what he's done for my university, you know, my alma mater. They came in at a hard time and has brought them to excellence. Pat Kraft, their AD, is one of my best friends. You know, great AD, was my AD at Temple. So it'll be fun to go there. The biggest thing I'll know is, hey, guys, get ready for the crowd noise because it's going to be really loud, right? It's just it's a really loud, raucous environment.
Well, what kind of relationship have you maintained with your alma mater, the State College area, in general? Do you
Yeah, you know, we used to go back a bunch. My grandmother unfortunately passed away a few years ago, and that was, you know, last time, you know, my aunt still lives there. Lots of family still there. But we get back. I went back last year. The College of Liberal Arts honored me. My wife was so mad because she had better grades than me, but they offered me Distinguished Alumnus. So I went back, and it was awesome to see. I got to get back and see people there. So there's a lot of people there that I love, family, friends, you know, love the paternal family. So I'm happy for Pat, happy for James, and so just when I can, I try to get back. Because Pat's gonna fight, scratch, and claw to help his coaches be successful. He cares about the student athletes. He's not afraid of anything. He's gonna go fight for what he wants. And he's a really good person.
Matt, are there other guys in this league? You mentioned Frank Lamb.
Yeah, I was really close, and I am really close with Pat Fitzgerald. I know, obviously, he's no longer there, but you know, the day I got fired in Carolina, Pat was one of the first guys that reached out to me. We were always on Under Armour trips together, so my wife and his wife and all of us got along. I would let my son go play for him anytime. I respect Pat, and I don't know what that situation is. I'm not commenting on that situation, but I trust him. You know, I've known PJ a long time. We came into head coaching together at Minnesota. And, you know, over the years, his wife and my wife, we've all gotten to know each other. I worked with Ryan Day at Temple. We were both on the staff together.